Welcome to this presentation on the STM32 MCUs in a graphical user interface context. A graphical application implies defining a graphical user interface layout and perform its rendering by processing all the graphical elements that compose it, but also requires to send the output of this rendering to the display. In the first section, we will focus on the specific IPs included in some of the STM32 microcontrollers that are dedicated to the rendering process. Then we will review the display interfaces that are supported by ST microcontrollers. The last two sections will focus on the ST ecosystem offer in the context of graphical application, and more specifically, how the TouchGFX solution fits into it. This is an overview of the graphic subsystem. The inputs are bitmaps and some text also that are converted into bitmaps anyway and are stored in flash memory. From this flash memory, the content is put together to fill the frame buffer, which is stored in RAM memory. And finally, this frame buffer is transferred to the display panel. So we have here two processes. First, the update, the build of the frame buffer, and then the partial or full refresh of the display given this frame buffer. We will focus in this first section on the graphics enabler that allows to accelerate the update of the frame buffer. What is the frame buffer filling complexity? A frame drawing is very CPU demanding operation. It requires to process each and every pixel of the frame buffer several times per second. Several times mean 60 times per second. For SVGA definition, it means that 480,000 pixels must be processed several times per second. The drawing involves mainly numerical computing operation, which are addition and multiplication, no logical operations. And these operations are very repetitive since they have to be done on each pixel. And it requires also many memory accesses, reading from the input bitmaps and writing to the frame buffer area. So this is very suitable for a dedicated IP, a 2D engine, instead of the general purpose Cortex that can be required to do other tasks in the application. That's why ST introduced the Chromart accelerator. It is much more efficient than the Cortex. It has a direct DMA access to memory and is dedicated to pixel processing. And compared to a graphical processing unit based approach that a GPU is found in most smartphones, for example, or on heavy systems such as a PC, for example, it is much smaller and it gives a much cheaper silicon, and it doesn't need extra RAM to process. And finally, it covers 90% of top-of-the-line graphical human-machine interface use cases. Here is a video that shows the difference when rendering a simple layout with images moving in front of a background with transparency computation, with blending computation. We will see in this video the difference of the CPU load when the Chromart is enabled and when it's not. So this demo is available in the Cube firmware package. So here the Chromart is enabled. We are blending, so you saw the fading effect of the ST logo appearance. The TouchGFX logo has also some transparency information. And they are blend in front of or back at the back of a given image that has also transparency, the tree. So when the Chromart is disabled, you see that the MCU load moves to, so here it's enabled, so it's 4%. When it's disabled, it goes up to 80% of the CPU load. The Chromart features are, of course, memory-to-memory DMA transfer with a programmable rectangle area, which allows to do some per-object alpha blending, but also per-pixel alpha blending. So here we only update a part of the frame buffer with the logo, taking into account a global alpha or a per-pixel alpha. in case of glyphs. Just as a reminder, a glyphs is the image representation of a character. The pixel format converter supports in input and output all the regular RGB format from 888 to 565, but also smaller one like the 1555 format. On the contrary, it does not support in output some lookup table format, because this would imply the calculation of a color lookup table. But the memory-to-memory operation without pixel format conversion can copy data independently of the format. So we can imagine that we have some input lookup table format images that are copied directly to the frame buffer, which is also in a L8 lookup table format. So it's a quite flexible approach, even if the lookup table format are not supported in output. And it also supports a YCBCR format for a higher motion JPEG frame rate. All the details of this chromat can be found in the application note 4943. The hardware JPEG, JPEG accelerator is a fully hardware JPEG compressor and decompressor, and it supports motion JPEG videos. It can then offload the CPU load, for the moving JPEG processing. The moving JPEG can be used and are mostly used for small short videos, such as, for example, tutorials to replace ink cartridge in printers. From 8 frames per second, you can go up to 20 frames per second using the hardware JPEG decoder. Again, an application note is dedicated to this JPEG accelerator. We are not going through all the details of all the API here, just mentioning what we mean by supporting the graphic acceleration in our MCU family. So the application note is the 4996. The Chrome GRC is also an optimization. It's not really an accelerator. It allows to support the non-square display, and it's fully configurable. The idea is to have all the access to the frame buffer controlled by a memory management unit that will decide if a pixel is actually stored or not in the memory. And if it's not stored, it will return a default value or do not write the value. So the gain is around 20% of RAM. So you only store the dark blue zone here in actual memory. The rest is a virtual, so it is accessed by the chromat, for example, but only by address. So if the chromat wants to access an address that is in this pink zone, it will be given a virtual value. This is most suitable for wearable devices and smartwatches, notably. The application note dedicated to the Chrome GRC is the 5051. So, in summary, the rendering process split is as follows. So, the ChromArt is designed for most of the rendering operation, that is, data copy with or without blading, data fill rectangle with or without transparency, and the pixel format conversion. The hardware JPEG decoder is in charge of decoding the JPEG images and encoding if needed. And all other operations are handled by the Cortex. This includes the smart rendering processing, the algorithm that will determine which zone of the frame buffer needs to be refreshed, and some primitive drawing also, like circles of or polygons, and all the geometric transformation, such as rotations or scaling. So when designing a graphical user interface layout, you have to keep in mind that all the processing will not necessarily be accelerated by the ChromArt. Some transformation are handled by a CPU, so you may see a raise of the CPU usage in this case. And all the advanced color effects are also handled by the Cortex. So now we are done with the frame buffer update, and we will focus on the display panel refresh. First, a reminder of display architecture. So the main panel of the display containing all the pixel values is controlled by two drivers, the source and gate driver for columns and rows. And this one is controlled by the timing controller. So any displays have such a timing controller, as well as a backlight usually. Then these two parts, the display controller and the frame buffer, are not in every display. And that's why ST decided to introduce an LTDC controller that we will see in the next slide. So in case the chosen display does not have a display controller, an embedded one, we provide an LTDC component, which is a TFT LCD controller. And the frame buffer is then stored on the MCU side also, either in internal RAM or in external RAM. So the LTDC key features, the LCD TFT controller, is a 24 bits RGB parallel pixel output up to XGA definition. This is not a physical limitation, it's a practical one, because when refreshing the screen, we are not dealing only with the memory bandwidth used by the TDC to access the frame buffer. We have also to consider that within the same pipe that goes to the frame buffer, the Chrome art, for example, will also update the another frame buffer in the same memory. So it will go within the same bus. So in practical, we did internally some benchmark, and this XGA size was the one that was the most suitable to support most of the use cases. But on the paper, in the LTDC application note, we will see that the LTDC is able to address a much larger screen definition. So depending on the use case, depending on the complexity of your user interface, you may address a larger display, larger definition. At least. So the LTDC is programmable in terms of display size and position, so it's able to refresh only part of the screen. We can configure, of course, all the timings and the polarity to address the widest range of displays. And the supported input ePixel format are RGB formats, but also some lookup table format. It has access to the AHB or AXI, depending on the MCU, interface to access internal and external memories. So it has a direct access to these memories. And it integrates also a dithering module. In a few words, dithering is the way to give the illusion that a given screen with a given color depth has a higher one. So it's a way to erase the effect of a low color depth on a given screen by creating some extra pixel color, but within the screen color palette. The MIPI DSI host is also an enabler, a graphic enabler, in the sense that even if it relies on the LTDC components, it allows to use the DSI, the MIPI DSI connection. And this MIPI DSI connection supports a much higher data transmission, but it especially allows a low pin count for a display interface, only 4 to 6. So you don't have all the parallel lines for each RGB component. You have only 4 to 6 because the data is serialized. So for that, you need, of course, a DSI display that supports this kind of data reception, but you need a DSI host on the MCU side, and that's what this component is for. And it also includes DeFi directly, so you do not have to add an extra component to convert the data at the output of the DSI host. The application note for this DSI host component is the 4860. So the STM32 family supports all the main display interfaces. It comes from the Intel 8080 and Motorola 6000 LCD interface for small resolution. In this case, the FMC is used to access the display, to send the command to the display. But this display has then an internal controller and an internal frame buffer. The Chrome art is in charge of filling the back frame buffer here. When it's ready, it is sent to the FMC through the FMC to the display. for the medium resolution up to XGA display, the dual TDC is used. So in this case, the Chromart is still in charge of filling the frame buffer, and the LTDC sends constantly one of the two frame buffer, depending of which one is ready to the display, and the display this time has no internal controller. Another use case is, for example, when the STM32, the chosen MCU, doesn't have enough RAM to store the two frame buffers. So in this case, the FMC is used again, but not to connect the display, but to access this external SDRAM containing the frame buffer. And that's exactly the use case that is quite a popular one. That's a use case when we can see the limitation in terms of the LTDC supported definition, because both Chromart and LTDC will have to access through this pipe to the frame buffer. So even if LTDC is able to transfer very large definition, there will be no room left for the Chromart to access the frame buffer and update it. So we have to find a compromise between the constant flow of the LTDC reading and sending the frame buffer to the display, and keeping some room for the Chromart to update this frame buffer. And eventually, for the application itself, accessing this external SDRAM for extra data. The MIPI DSI is also for medium resolution with a high pixel density graphical user interface, and supports the three scenarios we just listed, either using the LTDC or the FMC. The only difference here is the connection between the MCU and the display, which is reduced to a few pins. Let's now look at the STM32 ecosystem with first a global reminder, and then we will focus on the TouchGFX integration. The STM32 ecosystem is first composed of hardware development tools. So it's a set of evaluation boards and programming probes. But it's also composed of the corresponding software development tools, so including the configuration tools, debugging tools, and programming tools. And it comes also with some external software stack, such as drivers for the integrated devices, such as a microphone or displays or touch panel, but also some operating system stack and USB stack. And the fourth block of the STM32 ecosystem is the support part, which is composed of a website containing all the product definition and all the documentation of each product, but also the support sites such as the community, the ST community, and the online support system. All these four blocks are open source, can be provided by partners. For example, the embedded software part are provided by partners, as well as some support part, and is designed for the ST product. So in terms of hardware development tools, ST proposed some STM32 Nucleo boards, then some discovery kits, and also some evaluation boards. The difference between the three is that the Nucleo boards are dedicated for a flexible prototyping, in the sense that they have a large number of pins that are connected directly to the board, so that they can be connected to external devices, and they are highly configurable. On the contrary, the discovery kits have already some devices connected to it that cannot be changed easily, but usually are dedicated to a specific feature. And for the discovery kits with a graphic-enabled MCU inside, you usually will find a display with a touch controller and also some buttons to navigate through it if the touch controller is not mandatory. Finally, the evaluation board are much more expensive boards, but have all the devices, the possible devices connected, in terms of a microphone, of a temperature sensor, of buttons, display, everything, every Every device is connected to it. That's why also they are more expensive. And these kits are proposed for all the STM32 families from F0 to MP1. The hardware development tools also include some STM32 Nucleo expansion board for a specific functionality such as a wireless connectivity, Blue Energy, or USB. So these are sold separately and can be plugged using Arduino connectors, usually on the Nucleo boards and also on some evaluation boards. And also, we can find some third-party boards that are fully packaged for a specific feature. Regarding the software development tools, we first have the STM32 CubeMX tool, which is used for the MCU configuration, the full configuration. You have access to every pins of the MCU and can configure per peripheral the proper settings. And it also automatically generates from this configuration, from this visual configuration, it generates automatically the source code. This source code can be then used in an IDE, so in an integrated development environment. One is proposed for free by ST is the STM32 Cube IDE, which is an Eclipse-based IDE, but we also support some other IDEs such as IR or KIL. And this allows to compile and debug the application that you generated. The STM32 Cube Programmer is the tool to update the MCU when you to flash a given binary program to the MCU, but also to modify the option byte to enable specific feature of the MCU. And the STM32 Cube Monitor is a tool, a quite recently released tool, to monitor in a visual way most of the time. On a graph, for example, a specific variable of your application. On a given binary version of your application, you select with this tool which variable you will watch on a graph view or compare to other. So it's a really interesting way to also perform some debugging through monitoring of variables. So what about the TouchFX integration in this ST ecosystem? What does it mean developing with TouchFX? Enabling TouchFX involves to first create a user interface application. This is done using the TouchFX designer, which allows to create a user interface combining graphical elements and handling user events and also communicating with the non-UI part of the system. Once you have this application, you must plug the TouchFX library to the actual hardware. This is done with the abstraction layer development. It is not only the hardware abstraction layer because the TouchFX application also requires some software components such as a locking mechanism, which are usually provided by a real-time operating system, but can be also programmed in software. So it's more the AL than the HAL. The idea is to build a software layer that connects the TouchFX library with the hardware. For the ST development kit peripherals, so the screens that are on discovery kits and the external memory, the external SDRAM that are on our kits, the board-specific package, the BSP, is provided by ST. So all the application templates that are contained in the TouchFX Designer contains this board-specific package. You do not have to care about it as long as you work on a ST development kit. When you are working on a specific custom design with a screen that is not known by ST, with an external RAM also that is outside the set of external RAM ST uses, you need to configure it with the CubeMX along with the TouchFX plugin. So that's the way TouchFX is integrated in the ST ecosystem. First, using a standalone TouchFX designer, and then in the CubeMX for a specific configuration as a plugin. So we saw in the previous presentation that the TouchFX is composed of three blocks: the TouchFX designer, the TouchFX engine, and the TouchFX generator. So we'll now focus on this one. So the TouchFX come as a plugin of CubeMX. So you will find this term either TouchFX generator or TouchFX plugin or Xcube TouchFX. This points to the same block, which is the TouchFX plugin. But it can come in several terms. So it's a better interaction with the designer tool, because in this case you can generate the code from the CubeMX, taking into account the TouchFX configuration, but you can still generate the code from the TouchFX designer without breaking this link with CubeMX. It allows an independent version management, which means that before this plugin approach, the TouchFX version was tied to the CubeMX version. We could not add some more feature to the TouchFX integration. We could not add some extra features to the TouchFX until the next CubeMX release. It is now possible, and it's completely MCU independent. You are free to enable the TouchFX plugin on any MCU you choose. It's then up to you to be sure that you will be able to connect properly your screen through LTDC or through FMC or through SPI or maybe using GPIOs. The CubeMX plugin will help customer in defining the TouchFX abstraction layer for their custom board, but it will not do it for them. It will only give some guidelines, some empty function that needs to be filled depending on the chosen hardware. The guidance will also consist in enabling the required IP. For example, the CRC is mandatory when using TouchFX, while it's not a graphical component, but it's for confidentiality reasons to ensure that only STBoard will run the TouchFX library. The CRC module is used. It will help configure this IP. For example, if in the TouchFX plugin you set a given definition, but this definition does not correspond to the LTDC definition, it will give you a warning, and that we will see that during the lab. It will also help configure the TouchFX framework in general, setting the buffer management strategy and setting also the display definition. We identified that developing with TouchFX can be done in two approaches. The first use case, when someone wants to do some prototyping to a proof of concept, but on a STM32 display kits, so an STM32 discovery kit, for example, or evaluation kit. Then only the TouchFX designer is required, because it contains all the templates for most of the development kits, at least all the ones that have a graphic accelerator inside. The use case B is for real product development on STM32 based custom board. In this case, we will first use the STM32 CubeMX to configure your MCU, along with the TouchFX generator to configure the TouchFX abstraction layer, and then use the TouchFX designer to edit your user interface layout. So more details from the use case A. So the use case A, you use the TouchFX designer to start your project. You select a pre-made application template. So it will usually called AT for the specific kit that you choose. And then you can create your interface, generate the code, build the application, and directly flash from the TouchFX designer. You don't have to go outside it for a simple application to flash it directly on the board. Then, if you have to adapt the hardware configuration, for example, enabling some other IP such as ADC or another timer, or to have to tune the graphical user interface logic, then you will open the associated IOC file. The IOC file is the CubeMX project that is provided for most of the application templates dedicated to our dev kit. And using this IOC file, you will edit the CubeMX project in which the TouchGrafx generator will be already enabled and configured according to your board. And you could even change the ID among CubeID, IR, or KIL. The default one will be CubeID, but it can be changed using the CubeMX project. And then you will modify, build, and flash this application using the selected toolchain. Just be careful that this IOC file compatible with the CubeMX that supports the TouchGrafx plugin is not yet available for every application template. There are still some specific application templates for specific development kits that are in a legacy version, which is not compatible with the latest CubeMX version 5.5, the one that supports the CubeMX generator. But the target, of course, is that all application templates come in version 3.0 and thus contain a CubeMX project compatible with the TouchGrafx plugin. In use case B, you use a custom STM32-based board. Then you have to start from the STM32 CubeMX and select the MCU in the MCU list. And then enable the TouchGrafx generator from this new project. We will see just in the next slide how to enable it. After the first generation of the code of your project, you will have a .part file created, and this .part file will be the one to be used to open the TouchGrafx designer and start developing your user interface layout. It's different from the .touchgfx file because, in fact, it takes as input the configuration done in the TouchGrafx generator in terms of display definition and the chosen ID. So once you open this .part file, it will create a .touchgfx project file, which is an official TouchGrafx designer project file. In the CubeMX project, you will be free to select your preferred ID, either CubeID, IR, or KIL, and you will need to adapt the board bringer up code and the specific code that is needed for your specific hardware that cannot be managed by CubeMX. So we are talking about the BSP part, the board specific package of your setup. And finally, you can build and flash using your selected IDE. And note that here, the TouchGrafx designer is capable of retrieving the selected ID. So all the code that you will update from the TouchGrafx designer will be, if you add new files, for example, when you add screen, you add new source files, they will be added to the IDE project automatically because TouchGrafx designer is able to know what has been selected in CubeMX. So how do we practically enable the plugin in CubeMX? You have to go in this additional software button, which will open a dialog box. And at the end of this dialog box, well, it's at the end today because it's in alphabetical order. It may change, but you can find the Xcube TouchGrafx expression pack. And you have to set it to TouchGrafx generator. It's by default not selected. Once you did that, there is a new IP here in the IP list, which is the Xcube TouchGrafx plugin. You just have to enable the graphical application checkbox, and you will then be able to set up the important settings that the TouchGrafx library needs to generate the initialization code of the TouchGrafx abstraction layer. Just note that the way to enable the TouchGrafx plugin will not change, but this list of settings may evolve. There may be other settings in the future release. They may be organized differently also, but the documentation will be modified accordingly, of course. This is just a view to show you how to enable the plugin in the tool. So this plugin will generate some code, and this generated code comes into several parts. First, you have the HAL part, the hardware abstraction layer part. The HAL part contains the set of mandatory class and virtual function that are needed by the library to properly work. Also, part of the generated code is some customization of this HCL part based on the TouchGrafx generator settings. For example, the frame buffer size. As soon as you have set it in the TouchGrafx plugin, the generated code will take this into account, as well as the frame buffer management, if you have a single or double frame buffer. But all the settings that you set in the plugin will generate some specific source file that will be also read-only. The last part is the part of the source code that is generated only once by the plugin and then must be maintained by the user or edited most of the time. This is where you will add some specific initialization of your code. So it inherits from the generated HCL part, the classes that have been generated automatically will be the mother classes of this class. And also it generated only once. And it needs to be adapted according to your device's datasheet. For example, transferring the pixel from a frame buffer over SPI or enabling a PWM for the LCD backlight. This cannot be set in the QBMX project. It has to be set manually depending on your display datasheet. And using this TouchGrafx HCL user part, you are free to override or ignore even some functions that are defined in the generated part because they are not relevant in your case. This is the overview, in fact, of this approach. So the core part is the read-only part of the framework. So this is where the HCL class is defined. The HCL class is a very generic class that will that contains some field for display width and display height, but they are not set in this class. These are all virtual classes. As well for the DMA, these are some of the functions that will be used by the library to do some data copy and data fill. But then they will be customized here by the generator if you enable the Chrome art, for example. So this part will be customized automatically for part of it by the generator and manually for the rest for specific initialization. So this is in the F4 HCL STM32 H4 HCL class that it inherits from this generic HCL function class that will be implemented the SPI call for display refresh or the LTDC interrupt in case of LTDC communication with the display. And in this user STM32 F4 DMA class, this is where you will find the Chrome art API calls if you enable the Chrome art. Another way to show the TouchGrafx integration is to see it as a software layer. First, you have the user application. The user application consists in what you define in user interface in terms of image, of content, of logic, and of organization of the various graphical elements of your interface, and also the TouchGrafx configuration. Then you have the TouchGrafx core on which the user application is based, and the core is the part that comes with the source code of the TouchGrafx framework. So all the defined widget, the rendering engine, the event handling also of the library. And then this core part is based on the OS wrapper element and on the TouchGrafx generated abstraction layer. So this is the interaction with the hardware, the actual hardware. The OS wrapper is the how you will manage the synchronization of the library with the rendering process. So the OS wrapper can be the FreeRTOS, for example, but can be any other OS as long as you provide the proper function, the proper semaphore mechanism, but using another OS. And it can also be without OS as long as you provide a locking mechanism that can be, for example, a volatile variable that is set to 0 or 1. And it is set by a timer interrupt every 16 milliseconds so that the TouchGrafx library can have a signal to start the rendering process. So it's possible to use it without OS. But then you have to be very careful on the synchronization of the rendering of the frame regarding the refresh of the screen. On the TouchFX connection with the hardware, you have several possibilities. Either you use the ST Development Kit HAL, which is provided by in the Qube firmware and so in the application templates of the designer, with underlying low-level drivers for each of the devices. Or you use your custom board HAL using your custom user low-level drivers. So practically, in the case of ST Development Kit, you will configure all this using the TouchFX Designer only. So the layout is configured within it. The TouchFX configuration will be also set by default through the application template you choose for the development kit, and the same way for the FreeRTOS and the development kit low-level drivers. By default, all the application templates are using FreeRTOS. On the custom design use case, it's a bit different. So the TouchFX Designer will allow you to configure the user application part as far as the layout is concerned and also part of the logic. And we'll also use the underlying TouchFX core classes. But for the TouchFX configuration, you will need to use the TouchFX generator. And the TouchFX generator will also help you configure the TouchFX communication with the system and the OS wrapper part, because it's within the TouchFX generator that you will configure whether you use FreeRTOS or not. And the last part, missing part, is to if you choose another OS, for example, this is then up to you to within kubeidy to set up correctly the OS wrapper implementation, as well as if you use your custom devices, you have to provide and adapt the abstraction layer of TouchFX using a kubeidy, for example. So as a summary, there are two main use cases when working with TouchFX: either to start from the TouchFX Designer for ST Development Kit prototyping, or you use the ST ecosystem for custom board, which consists of the CubeMX configuration tool and the Xcube TouchFX expansion pack to enable TouchFX. We only covered the main principle in this presentation, because there is still much to say about TouchFX. And fortunately, today there is a very in-depth documentation on TouchFX. It can be found at this address. It contains some basic concepts of what is a frame buffer, what is a graphic engine, what is the main loop of the frame rendering. It also contains some guidelines, some user guide on how to use and configure the TouchFX generator section parameter per parameter. It contains also a section on the abstraction layer to understand what is covered by the TouchFX plugin and what should be done by the user. And also some general issues that can be encountered when bringing up a board. What to look first. For example, if you have no display, you have to be sure that you can set the display to a full color before trying to refresh it with the TouchFX library. There is some basic concept on known issues when developing on a custom board. And also, you can find some this kind of rendering flow examples to understand what is needed in terms of synchronization and why you need a semaphore locking system so that the library can work properly. And additionally, to help you develop in TouchFX. So this help may come from the designing of a user interface, but also up to the hardware configuration of a specific custom design. We have a list of partners that can help you, giving up some training, giving just some support on a given topic. And as you can see, Mjolnir is still very active in supporting a TouchFX application. Thank you for your attention. This is the end of this presentation.